Well, greetings, brothers and sisters. My name is Minister John Pickens of Revelational Ministries, and I would like to take this time to thank you, amen, for joining us on another Bible History Series episode. Amen. You could have joined in with any other podcast, but thank you again for all of your support, for coming here with us today, amen, to partake, amen, the Word of God. Bless his holy name today. Well, praise the Lord, everyone. Yes, praise the Lord. The Bible says, let everything that had breath praise ye the Lord, for his praise shall continually be in our mouths today. Amen. Before I go any further, I always have to start by giving honor to God and my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for saving me from my sins and commissioning me to preach his word, which is the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ to his people all around the world. Amen. Now, for today's text, we are going to continue, amen, our journey into the book of Genesis, into the story of creation. Whereas the first episode, we essentially talked about the creation of the world in 6 days. As we know, the Lord our God rested on the seventh day. So now we are moving this forward into the completion of that process, as well as the Garden of Eden. Bless his holy name today. Now, tonight's scripture and text will be coming from the book of Genesis, chapter 2, verses 1 through 25. That's the book of Genesis, chapter 2, verses 1 through 25. Amen. Again, I will be reading from the New King James Version. However, you are more than welcome to follow along with whichever version you have available to you. And I will begin at verse 1. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the host of them were finished. And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all the work which God had created and made. This is the history of the heavens and the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, before any plant of the field was in the earth, and before any herb of the field had grown. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the earth, and there was no man to till the ground, but a mist went up from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. The Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed, and out of the ground the Lord God made every tree grow that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Two separate trees that have two significant meanings that we will also be getting into. Verse 10 says, now a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it parted and became four river heads. The name of the first is Pishon. It is the one which skirts the whole land of Havilah. And there was gold, and the gold of that land is good. Bedlam and the onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one which goes around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is Hiddekel. It is the one which goes towards the east of Assyria. The fourth river is the Euphrates. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden to tend and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may eat freely, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall surely die. And the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him. Out of the ground the Lord made every beast of the field and every bird of the air, and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them. And whatever Adam called each living creature, that was its name. So Adam gave names to all cattle, to the birds of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper comparable to him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. Then the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, he made into a woman, and he brought her to the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. Amen. May the Lord bless both the hearers and doers of his word. Let us all pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord, for this blessed day. We thank you, Lord, for this precious communion and fellowship that we have with one another. Even though we may not know one another around the world, we want to thank you, Lord, for being the Lord our God, because beside you, Heavenly Father, there is no other. And we pray, Lord, that this word tonight seep deep down into our spirits and hearts so that it can continue to bring forth your truth, which is the revelation of this world, which is the revelation of Jesus Christ. In your blessed name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Brothers and sisters, again, thank you, amen, for joining us for the word of God for this night of Bible history. Amen. So now we are continuing the story of creation. Now we have here the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them. This is verse 1. And on the seventh day, God ended his work and rested. So this day, brothers and sisters, is generally speaking considered, this is the Sabbath day. It's typically celebrated on a Saturday. But we know church services universally are started on Sunday. Now, many people will say, well, why do we have this dichotomy? Why do we have this split decision, so to speak, or this, you could say, duality of approach to the Sabbath day? Well, Sunday typically is regarded the day, the holy day, which we celebrate in terms of church services, because we know Jesus, amen, rose on the third day. The third day is generally is Sunday morning, whereas the Sabbath day is technically Saturday. Now, depending on what denomination you are, some are very strict. It must be Saturday in which church services are conducted. Others, it's fair to celebrate the Sabbath day on Sunday. And then there are other denominations that actually celebrate both Saturday and Sunday as holy days. But generally speaking, in our work force, we somewhat observe the weekend as you could say holy days, because it's the weekend that the majority of workers around the country, if not the world, have off. Now, we know there are other countries with 6-day work weeks, certain Orthodox faith systems with 6-day work weeks. But generally speaking, we have a 5-day work week. We rest on the weekend. This is all representative, amen, of the Lord resting on the seventh day. So this is the history of the heavens and the earth when they were created in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, before any plant of the field was in the earth and before any herb of the field had grown. Yes, brothers and sisters, before anything was, God always is. He always was, he always is, and he always will be. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the earth, and there was no man to till the ground. It's also very important to know, brothers and sisters, in those days, yes, there was a point in time which the rain had not yet fallen. And it's significant because, again, there was no man to till the ground. No one had been given the tasking yet to take care of the foliage, to take care of the plants, to take care of things. So everything was watered, it says here, by a mist. Verse 6, a mist that went up from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. So, yes, it's very sufficient for plants to be watered with dew. So the dew on the ground is actually what caused the plants, amen, to get the nourishment that they needed from the ground. And this would continue later as we get into the flood from Noah. This would continue all the way into the flood rains of Noah fell upon the face of the earth. Verse 7, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. This is significant, brothers and sisters, for so many reasons. As we see, the Lord breathe nostrils, amen, into the man's nostrils, or breathe life into the man's nostrils. Now, notice he did not do this with the other creatures. The other creatures were just formed. They were formed from the ground, whereas mankind here, starting with Adam, we see he was formed of the dust of the ground. But there was an extra ingredient. The Lord breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. He breathed his spirit, brothers and sisters. So yes, you are carrying, amen, the spirit of God on the inside of you. So many, I think USA Today and other publications state that depression is on the rise in America. Depression is on a rise various places around the world. And many times because we do not know who we are. We are not, brothers and sisters, the sum of our bank accounts. We are not the sum of our accomplishments. We are not the sum of the thing, materialistic things, how many properties you own, how much land and real estate you own. You carry, brothers and sisters, the breath of life, the breath of God, the spirit of God is inside of you. So that is more than enough reason, brothers and sisters, to get out. We do not get our validation from the world. There's nothing wrong with certain types of self-affirmations, but understand those do not carry the weight as having the weight of the Almighty God on the inside of you. And it says, and man became a living being. So he created man of the dust. But man was not yet alive until he breathed his breath of life into him. Brothers and sisters, we are alive in Christ Jesus. Amen. He came to set the captives free. Who the Son sets free is free indeed. From the book of Genesis to the book of Revelations, brothers and sisters, it is important for us to know who we are and who we have on the inside of us. Greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. Amen. The Lord, our God, brothers and sisters, is in us, and he wants us to be in him, a part of his body. Now, verse 8 says, the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed, and out of the ground the Lord made every tree grow that is pleasant to the sight and food good for food. Now, brothers and sisters, this is symbolic of the Lord creating for mankind a place to live. He created the world, brothers and sisters. The 5 days he created the world, the 6 days, that is when he created man. So on the sixth day, man and woman were created. So the Lord sets a blueprint for all of us. He sets a blueprint that before we bring our families into this world, we need to make sure that we have nourishment for them. Make sure you have a nest in nature. Before animals actually have children, specifically birds, they try to find a shelter, a place of dwelling, because that is the proper procedure, the proper process put in place by the Lord our God. Now, is this to say that if there are situations happening where children come before there's both parents in the household or before there's resources, is something wrong with the child? Is the person's cursed? No, the children are always a gift from the Lord, brothers and sisters. But the Lord sets this blueprint for all of us to understand that it is best, amen, it is best to make sure we provide resources. It is best that we have a nest for our families, because the Lord did not create Adam and Eve and place them in the middle of space. He didn't place them on Mars where there was no water. He didn't do that. And too oftentimes we see our orphanages right now, our adoption centers are overflowing with children because we fail to plan. We fail to plan as human beings. This is not to get on one person or another. This is just to look at our state, our fallen state of man compared to the plan that the Lord our God had put in place for all of us. Now, next, we're going to get into two very interesting entities here. Verse 9 goes on to say the tree of life was also in the midst of the garden. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil were also there. So we have a dichotomy of two different trees, one being that of life, the other being the knowledge of good and evil. Very interesting. Now, we know the bread of life in the word of God is referred to as his word, the Bible, as we know. But what is this tree of knowledge of good and evil? Well, there's much speculation about this amongst theologians. Many speculate that it's just, it's oftentimes referred to as simply an evil tree. But there's another connotation for it. Another connotation by some theologians, they speculate it actually represents reasoning. Because for those who have studied any bit or a little bit of philosophy, we know that that is the study of reasoning and logic. At least that's how it's described in the colleges, which it is. Well, you have the tree of life here, and then you have the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Many would try to make this comparable to, you could say, going to college, right, where you learn, all sorts of things from history to math, to all sorts of challenging subjects. Well, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, again, could be really ascribed to and comparable just to plain old reasoning, amen, reasoning and logic. So why would that be opposite of the tree of life? Well, the tree of life, brothers and sisters, again, is representative of the word of God. You see, the Lord our God is God. He is a spirit. So he created man and woman in his image. So yes, men and women are created in the image of God, brothers and sisters. So in other words, there is a God likeness to our image. There is a God likeness to our presence because this is from him. So he placed a tree here. Again, one connotation could be we can eat of the fruit that makes us like him, or we can eat of the fruit that gives us knowledge of good and evil. In other words, which gives us reasoning skills. Now, some would say, well, what's wrong with reasoning? Well, reasoning in and of itself is not a bad thing. But if you're reasoning between choosing God or choosing the world, that is where Adam and Eve went south. And that's what that tree essentially represents, or at least one connotation of it. So choosing between God and the world, that's how you could also look at these two trees. You have God, you have the world, you have the things of the world. Remember, he said he placed us in the world, but not to be of the world. So he placed Adam and Eve in this garden. And we're going to get into their jobs in a second. He placed them in this garden with things to do, and they had a choice. You could eat of any tree, not just the tree of life. You could eat of any tree that was in the garden. But there was one tree specifically that he commanded them not to touch, and that would be the tree for the knowledge of good and evil. Now, verse 10 says, now a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it parted and became four river heads. The name of the first is Pishon. It is the one which skirts the whole land of Havilah. And there was gold. So yes, there was gold, brothers and sisters, in the Garden of Eden. And the gold of that land is good. Bedlam and the onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one which goes around the whole land of Cush. Cush, as we know, is considered current day Ethiopia. At least the surrounding area of that is known as Ethiopia. And next we have the name of the third river is Hiddekel. It is the one which goes toward the east of Assyria. The fourth river is the Euphrates. We've all heard of the Euphrates River before. Oftentimes, the river Hiddekel is ascribed the Tigris River. So we've heard of the Tigris River and the Euphrates River before, but there's two others. So then the Lord God took man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and to keep. The King James Version says to dress and to keep. So this was Adam's job, brothers and sisters. Now, Adam is not just, again, the name of Adam. Adam, as referenced the Apostle Don Jones, she studies this extensively. According to her, the name Adam is also the name of mankind. So Adam, the Lord God put man into the Garden of Eden to dress and to keep. This was the original job for Adam. The Lord always gives every animal, every human being a job to do. None of us have been placed on this earth to do nothing, brothers and sisters. So our first job goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden, to dress and to keep, amen, to name the animals of the field, to name the plants, to name the trees. He gives every animal, every creature, brothers and sisters, has a function in life. It may be to fertilize another plant. It may be to devour another animal. Whatever its job is, the Lord has given everything a job to do. Everything has a place and purpose, brothers and sisters. To everything, there is a season. Now, verse 16 says, the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. So we have a clear command from the Lord, brothers and sisters, to man, to Adam, that they should not eat of this tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Brothers and sisters, is this not representative of what's happening today? There's nothing wrong. Now, many, you could say, Christian fundamentalists may say, well, this is why we should not go to college, because college is going to fill our minds with philosophy and all these other things. Well, this is not specifically what's actually happening here. What is happening here is the Lord has given mankind a choice. Follow me, have eternal life, or follow your own way. And sometimes, brothers and sisters, we try to rationalize what the tree of knowledge of good and evil really means. What is the real connotation of it? What is the symbolism of it? What is actually happening here? Well, the reality is, brothers and sisters, there may not have been anything more significant than what happened than what the command that the Lord gave us. Sometimes he will just tell us, just don't do this. Don't do this. Don't try to figure out why you should not eat of the fruit of this particular tree. Don't try to always figure out why you shouldn't lie. Or obviously, we know there are certain commandments. We know there's obvious repercussions for this. You should not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. Again, you should not lie. You should not murder. We know of those things. But oftentimes, there's going to be certain commands he gives us that we're not going to truly understand. And because we don't understand it, we rationalize whether or not it's right and wrong. This is the product of the fruit of that tree, brothers and sisters. And he gives us a choice. There is going to be many things that we just do not understand. Think of it in this way. There's been lots of talk in our lexicon or our culture about the unknown, and there always has been. We do not know, brothers and sisters, what is inside a dark hole. We do not know what is located at the bottom of the sea. There are certain things that we are just not going to know. Now, some would say, well, we don't have the technology yet. That's fair. We do not have the technology yet. But then again, there's something to suggest or a train of thought that says we may never have it because there are certain things that we just aren't supposed to know as human beings. But yet we have an insatiable knowledge to know everything. And that is what's going to get Adam and Eve in trouble here. And that is what continuously gets all of us as mankind in trouble. Now, some would say, well, brother, that's the essence of science, to continue to study, to try to find the unknown. This is why many scientists, brothers and sisters, oftentimes have issues with religion in general, or specifically with the book of Genesis. Why? Because many of them do not understand that both science can actually flow in tandem with the word of God, just like any other field, whether it's math, science, history, computer science. All of these things can actually flow in tandem with the word of God because the Lord created everything. He created science, brothers and sisters. So the very scientists or minds that try to go against his word, the reality is it should flow in tandem. It should be very congruent. Instead of speaking the theory of evolution versus creationism, that really should not have ever been a real debate. Creation and evolution, brothers and sisters, flow hand in hand. Why? There cannot be evolution without creation first. Everything had to come from somewhere. Before one animal evolved into its next form, it had to be created from the beginning. So it's really arguing, which comes first, 2 + 2 = 4. It doesn't matter which two comes first. There has to be another set to add together to create 4. So before there can be evolution, there has to be creation. Then there can be evolution. So there is a way that all of our studies in our fields, whether you're a lawyer, a doctor, a PhD scholar, no matter what you are, brothers and sisters, all of these things should flow in congruence with the word of God. However, because of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, we now find ourselves questioning not simply how can we have the cure for cancer. We're questioning our very existence. We're questioning the very existence of God himself. We're questioning the very good and evil, whether or not certain things should be moral, whether or not certain things should be immoral. These are all products of the knowledge, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. So the word of God goes on to say, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Now, we know that the word of God will go on to talk about Adam and Eve. They're going to live for quite some time after this incident takes place. But spiritually, brothers and sisters, the word of God here is to let us know that there's another form of life. There's our physical life, but there's our spiritual life, because there's always two realms happening. There's always the physical realm that we see, and then we know that there's the spiritual realm. So you can be alive physically, but you could be spiritually dead. And this is what he is talking about. If we do not eat of the tree of life, if we do not take of his bread of life, that is going to be the day, brothers and sisters, that we spiritually, amen, perish. Now, does not mean that you cannot be revived, does not mean that you cannot be resurrected. In fact, we are born into this world in a spiritually dead state. We're physically alive, but our spirits, in a sense, are not physically where they need to be because we have not accepted Christ into our life. Once we do that, once we accept that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, that is going to be the day that we start to partake to eat of the bread of life. Amen. Now, we know the tree of life is in heaven, but we know that the bread of life is here with us, and that is the word of God. And the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him. Out of the ground, the Lord formed every beast of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them. So brothers and sisters, the Lord formed all of the animals, all of the plants. He formed everything. But notice again, he only breathed his breath. He only breathed his spirit into man. So many, again, including myself, I love animals and plants. But brothers and sisters, human beings stand a cut above all of them. Why? Because the Lord actually breathed his spirit into us. So that means we have a real fundamental purpose. We have a much more fundamental purpose than simply just animals. Amen. We have lots of things that we have been tasked to do. So in whatever Adam called each living creature, that was its name. So Adam gave names to all the cattle, to the birds of the air, and to the every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a comparable helper to him. So the task of Adam continues to this very day, which is why we have scientists of all cultures around the world continuously naming animals, continuously naming organisms, and all sorts of creatures. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, and he slept. And he took one of its ribs, closed up the flesh in its place. So this is the first surgery. So there's a lot actually happening here. Not only is the Lord our God creating things left and right, he now performs the first surgery ever recorded, which here says he caused Adam to go into a deep sleep. So this isn't suggesting that Adam had never taken a nap before, because many people are speculating, okay, well, was Adam a God at this particular sense? Was he in some sort of God form? Was he immortal prior to him eating of the fruit? Well, you could say so, because there was no need for him to die. He had not yet betrayed or went against the instruction of the Lord. So some would say, well, then why would he need sleep? Well, the Bible says here the Lord rested on the seventh day. So it says here a deep sleep. So perhaps Adam slept already, but this is just going to be an additional sleep. I know some would, you know, look at this as semantics, but it's just very interesting when you really pay attention to all of the language here of the word of God. So Adam fell into a deep sleep caused by the Lord, and the Lord took one of his ribs and close up the flesh in its place. This is representative, brothers and sisters, that men and women both are from originally the same body. They're both two halves of the same coin, so to speak. And yet there is so much unfortunate debate, so much unfortunate rivalry, not just today, but since the beginning of time, since this situation between Adam and Eve, there has been a rivalry. At times a silent rivalry, at other times a violent rivalry between men and women. And that's going to manifest itself through Cain and Abel. So where did Cain get his violence from? Where did this actually take place? It came from Adam and Eve. Disobeying the Lord has consequences, brothers and sisters. So the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, he made into a woman, and he brought her to the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Many people suggest today that because woman came from men here in the word of God, this is why ultimately there is such a pursuit from men to have women back into their lives. Because for the two to become one again, because whatever the Lord, brothers and sisters, puts together, no man can put asunder. Again, this comes from his word. This comes from the book of Genesis. The Lord created something to be together. It is going to constantly seek to be together. Now, we're not talking simply about marriage. This is relationships. This is familyships. You're not going to have a family without men and women. Now, some would say, well, I can have children and raise children on my own. No, you're going, in order to have a nation state, which is a collection of people, an empire, a tribe, there are going to be men and women involved in it. I know there's lots of fairy tales about, you could say, the Amazons and whatnot, but the reality is, brothers and sisters, you're going to have men and women contained in a family. You're going to have both men and women. This is the equation that the Lord our God had put into place. Now, I know many of us are very good with math, and we love algebra. We love all the various formulas, right? A squared plus B squared equals C squared. We have all of these formulas that we use, the Pythagorean theorem, all of our theories. And what we can do is we'll substitute X for Y, or we'll substitute B for C. Well, brothers and sisters, a man and a woman is not an equation that can be substituted for. You're not going to substitute A for B or B for A or B for B. You need a man and a female, brothers and sisters, as ordained here by the word of God. Now, verse 24 says, therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and they were not ashamed. So at this point, brothers and sisters, keep in mind, Adam and Eve were not yet ashamed of their status because they had not broken, amen, the promise. They had not broken the word from the Most High. And they were given, again, the choice of these trees. You could eat of the tree of life and every other tree in the garden, including the herbs. There was one tree that they were not supposed to touch, the tree of knowledge, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Amen. The tree of reasoning. Amen. The tree of, as we would say, reasoning and logic. Now, again, reasoning and logic, this is not a cast an aspersion on anyone studying philosophy or any of my debaters or anyone, brothers and sisters, who partakes in this. However, we can say this. One of the essence of reasoning is questioning things. And oftentimes, many people will say one of the, you could say, detractions of studying certain forms, at least of philosophy, is the fact that you continuously just ask questions. You're asking question after question after question, rarely getting to results. Now, many people will say, well, that is a good thing. We need people to question authority. We need people to question certain things. And yes, if you're trying to come up with the cure for disease, or you're trying to build a bridge to make sure that the cargo or the convoy, military convoy, makes it across the water safely. Well, sure, some people need to question the foundations. However, when it comes to the things of God, brothers and sisters, when the Lord says don't do something, it is to our best benefit not to do it. Now, the enemy, as we're going to get into, he's always going to be there. And oftentimes the enemy is us, our inner self, our inner me, which is going to keep ourselves from following his instructions. But there's a reason that why he told them, do not eat of this tree. Do not break of his commandments. Many people will try to say, well, what did Jesus say about this sin specifically? Or he didn't say anything about this particular union of people or that particular course of action. Because the word of God lists 10 commandments of the old Mosaic Levitical code in the book of Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, it does not list certain things that we do today, such as, look, televisions. There were no televisions back in those days. So did the word of God cover televisions? Did it cover social media? Did the word of God cover the internet? Certain types of technology, the advanced military equipment that we have today? Much less all of the various forms of relationships that we have today. What did the word of God say? Well, Jesus covers that. He says, listen, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. If you love me, you will not eat of the tree that I commanded you not to eat. So that's the challenge for us today, brothers and sisters. Are we going to go to God and enumerate every single thing that is not listed in the book of the Ten Commandments, or every single thing that is not listed specifically in the word of God, when Jesus says specifically, look, if you love me, you will keep my commandments that you love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, that you love thy neighbor as thyself. Amen. If you do those two things according to Christ, amen, in the Gospels, then all of the rest of the law falls into place. So first, loving the Lord your God with all your heart. If the Lord your God has instructed you, do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, then don't do it. You don't need a specific command, brothers and sisters, to say, do not engage in this relationship. Do not engage in that business practice. You don't need a specific law that says that. When his word covers essentially everything, it covers everything, brothers and sisters. Remember, heaven and earth will pass away, but his word will remain forevermore. So thank you for joining me, brothers and sisters, for this next episode of Bible History. As we have many, many more, we are just getting started. We are just scratching the surface for the word of God, brothers and sisters, is eternal. So please continue to join me on Facebook on Tuesday nights at 8 p.m. for prayer, on Thursday nights at 8 p.m. for Bible study, Sunday mornings at 11:30 a.m. for the word of God. Continue to follow us on YouTube at Revelational Warfare Ministries. And please email us at revelationalwarfareministries@yahoo.com. Thank you. Thank you again for joining us. I am Minister John Pickens of Revelational Ministries. I want to thank you all, amen, for joining me for this word of God. Let us all pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for this occasion that you have blessed us with to gather together again, to have fellowship and companionship. We thank you, Lord, for your word as we continue to grow in it, as it continues to spread around the world as you have called for it to do so. And we pray over each one of us. We pray for protection from all hurt, harm, and danger, both the seen and the unseen, as we continue to live our lives according to your will and your way. In your precious holy name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Thank you again, brothers and sisters, for joining me. Have a very, very blessed night.